Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank the organizers for setting up such a nice trimester and to give me the opportunity to give another talk at this trimester. The previous talk I gave was much about differential geometry and image analysis, mathematical image analysis. This talk will be a little differently oriented. It will be mainly focusing on geometry and machine learning. So the title of the talk is Rotor Translation Equivariant Convolution Networks for Medical Image Analysis. And I present here a work by Eric Beckers and myself in collaboration from people from the Biomedical Engineering Department at Eindhoven University of Technology. So let me start with the outline of the presentation. First of all, I will start with two motivations for rotor translation equivariant convolutional neural networks. The first motivation comes from the fact that I apply in my research geometric image analysis via orientation scores. And in the previous talk at the second workshop, I presented this general framework. It's a differential geometrical framework where you basically extend the spatial domain of images to the homogeneous space of positions and orientations embedded in the Lie group of rotor translations. And then you do the image analysis on multi-orientation representations of images. You can think of tracking, but or enhancement. And these, in the previous talk, I gave many examples of such geometric image analysis techniques. And they have big advantages over common tracking or enhancement techniques acting directly in the spatial image domain, because they can deal with crossings and bifurcations. And in principle, that is nice, but still you have in your tracking algorithms or in your diffusion algorithms, diffusion matrices or stiffness parameters that are currently set by hand. And we need to automate such geometric image analysis on the space of positions and orientations. And one way to automate that is by means of rotor translation equivariant convolutional neural networks. So that's the first motivation. There's a second motivation directly for machine learning, where in many machine learning applications you have a convolutional neural network, and it's very important that your network basically that it is it has a group equivariance in there. If I rotate and translate my images, the classification should rotate and translate accordingly. Then I will provide an overview of related work, because there's recently quite a few research groups are entering this field of group equivariant neural networks. And then I provide a theoretical background where we start off with common neural networks. And then we go to take the tour, put some geometry in there by going to convolutional neural networks, and then more geometry, because that will be needed. Then we take the tour from convolutional neural networks to group equivariant convolutional neural networks. Then I will provide a general theorem on equivariant linear operators. And this general theorem of equivariant linear operators basically imposes big constraints on the architecture of group convolutional neural networks. Then we set up this architecture of group convolutional neural networks, and we apply these techniques to three different, very different medical imaging applications, and where we achieve state-of-the-art results. And then I come to the conclusion of this talk. Okay, so let us start off with equivariant image analysis via orientation scores. I presented this before in the second workshop of this trimester, but let me first provide a general overview and how machine learning can make a difference in this, this framework. So in this framework, the first step is you have an image, you convolve your image with a family of anisotropic wavelets, and then you get a distribution on position and orientation space, what we call an orientation score. And this basically extends the image domain, the spatial image domain, to space and orientation. And this can be done by a coherent state type of transform, so that we don't tamper the data evidence when going to this new representation. And there we have the framework of invertible orientation scores that I developed long ago. And yeah, that allows you to robustly relate operators here to operators in the image domain. The big advantage of going to the orientation score is that elongated structures involved in crossings are manifestly disentangled in the space of positions and orientations, as we can see here. So we no longer suffer from crossings. We also see that basically if I take a circle, that I get circular spirals in this position and orientation space. And here we see already curves of constant torsion and constant curvature. And this is important because if we put the left Cartan connection on this rotor translation group, then we have a space, a curved and torque geometry on this space of positions and orientations, and embedded as a quotient in the rotor translation group. But in the case of 2D, this quotient is trivial because then you can identify the homogeneous space of positions and orientations with the rotor translation group. In 3D, this is more subtle, of course. Okay, so let's see here. Here we have an image, and then we see basically here this, this circle, it becomes a spiral, and the lines are nicely disentangled. And now I can do PDE-based processing, not in the image domain, but in this new domain of positions and orientations. So then we just looked at highly successful PDE approaches in the image domain, and then we replaced the generators of DX, basically of this translation group, DX, DY. We replaced them by the corresponding equivariant or left invariant vector fields on the rotor translation group. And this also makes sense from the applied point of view, because if you do processing up here, you have to think in a local frame, a moving frame of reference. And if I go up in the score, this moving frame of reference, it rotates. So then you can do PDEs like iconal PDEs, nonlinear diffusions, total variation flows, mean curvature flows. You just plug in for your derivatives this moving frame of reference, and then you can solve these PDEs either numerically. And there were quite some open challenges to tackle some of these linear PDEs on the rotor translation group analytically. And this was also some new mathematics that we had to develop for that, and we succeeded in that. So here you see the framework. So suppose here we have the image, the corresponding orientation score. This is a 2D image and the corresponding orientation score over here. And then we apply processing, geometric processing, on this orientation score. And this is a 2D image. Here you see an example of tracking in the orientation score, where we no longer suffer from the crossings. And this is done along globally optimal subriemannian geodesics or subfinslerian geodesics in the space of positions and orientations. And then you can do you have the advantage that basically you can do tracking without suffering from errors at crossings. We have published a few papers on this topic. I think the recent paper in GMIV together with Jean-Marie Mirabeau gives a very comprehensive overview for the 2D and 3D case and with lots of new mathematical theorems and applications. And then there is the geometric processing of enhancement, so in this case a crossing preserving diffusion, but as we saw previously it could also be a total variation flow or mean curvature flow. And then you go to the space of positions and orientations. This is now a 5D space. And then here you see a visualization of the, such a orientation score. And then we basically apply the crossing preserving diffusions over here. And then we nicely preserve the crossings and enhance the elongated structures, as you can see over here. Okay, so this was geometric processing. But yeah, we would like to include some machine learning to automate basically diffusion matrices in the long run, or to automate the kernels that we use to solve these PDEs. And here I would like to make a distinction, because in the long run this is our objective, because we have these nonlinear diffusions with lots of applications to deal with crossings and complex vasculature in 3D. But let us start first with the linear diffusion systems, on convection diffusion systems, on position and orientation space. Well, diffusion on position space, we know, okay, if we do a diffusion system on the unbounded domain, we have a convolution with a Gaussian kernel. And a Gaussian kernel, how can we get a Gaussian kernel? We do a Monte Carlo simulation of a drunk man's walk, and then in the limiting case you get this Gaussian distribution. But you can also have drunk man drives or drunk man flights. So it's not just random. The motion is constrained spatially because you have to follow your orientation, but you can randomly change your orientation. It was an open problem in mathematics to derive the exact solutions for the Drunkman drives and for the Drunkman flights. And I provided concise analytic formulas for these kernels. And since they are linear evolutions on the Lie group, these evolutions are solved by group convolution on the Lie group. Just like normal diffusion on Rn, you solve it by convolving it with a Gaussian. So these linear PDEs, they are solved with probability kernels, and I derived many analytic new solutions to these probability kernels, but also tangible Gaussian approximations with the right symmetries, and that we apply in practice. So here you see a visualization on position orientation space of such a limiting distribution. So you basically solve a linear diffusion on your orientation score by replacing every oriented element by such a kernel, by convolving your data with the corresponding kernel on position and orientation space. But okay, the next step is to train the shape of these kernels and their offsets, so that we adapt these kernels locally to the data. And this is something that we did from 2014 onwards. A nice paper by Eric Beckers in IEEE PAMI. And I will explain this a bit. So we started off with a basic approach. So let's first do template matching. We know template matching in Rn. And we're not going to do the template matching in the position space, but we go to this orientation score and do the template matching on position orientation space. So we have a template over here, and then we convolve this orientation score and select the optimal position in the image to find basically, for example here, the optic disc, to find anatomically interesting regions. So for example here we have a retinal image and we want to find the optic nerve head from which all the blood vessels depart. So we did a technique, and instead of doing the template matching in directly on the images, we did the template matching in the space of positions and orientations. And then we have this problem of finding this optimal position is just this optimization problem. But of course, you need to find the template, and the template minimizes a certain energy that I will explain right now. So what is this energy? Well, the energy has basically, you have training patches and labels, and then you put a prior, a probabilistic prior on your template. And for this, we use a Tiganov regularization, because we know Tiganov regularization is related to diffusion by a Laplace transform with respect to time. And then you can solve this this problem analytically in specific cases. And then we can check also if the numerics is in line with the analytic solutions. Okay, so here we have training patches that live in position orientation space. We take the inner product with the template, and then we have the labels. And then this is basically the data term, and then here we get the prior. And for the prior, it's very important. We don't do Riemannian geometry, but sub-Riemannian geometry, because for the regularization, you want your particles to proceed along your orientation spatially, not to step aside like a car, and to change their orientation. So this is basically not a full gradient, but a sub-Riemannian gradient. The commutators, they do fill the whole space, so it's well posed because of Hermander. And then, so this is a sub-Riemannian Brownian prior. And then you can solve this problem. And in a specific case that I, for example, have one training patch, just one delta spike, the solution is basically given over here. Now, this is a convex optimization problem here still. And we train the parameters via generalized cross-validation. So we can train these diffusion parameters that enter the sub-Riemannian gradient, we can train them by generalized cross-validation, and we have a complex problem, and we expand everything in B-splines, and then we are very close to the exact solutions that we can compute analytically. So this is a good check for your numerics always. Okay, but this is only a first step, because we construct the orientation score, and then we apply a kind of a smoothed regression problem on the orientation score by convolving your orientation score with a kernel that you basically train. But the next step is to train the transform between image and orientation score, the kernel that you used to construct your score, to train the first convolution that you apply to your orientation score, like we applied for the template matching, but to also extend it to deeper layers, multiple convolutions. So we get convolutional neural networks in the orientation score domain. Okay, some related work on group equivariant networks. Of course, we have the group convolutions on Z2 by LeCun, the famous work where it was very shown, it's very effective approach. Then Stefan Malat put up a very nice theory for scattering operators, and he combined that with support vector machines to do machine learning via scattering. And since I was in the PhD committee of Laurent Siffre, Stefan Malat's PhD student who did an excellent PhD thesis on this topic. It made me inspire me basically to integrate these deeper group convolutional layers into the convolutional neural networks with a practical design where you have ReLUs with codomain transformations instead of, for example, the modulus that one uses with the scattering. And then we generalize that to these group convolutional neural networks. Then in the work that I presented before, the work by Eric Beckers, basically there we had this template matching, but it's actually, in fact, a two-layer group convolutional neural network. And then the next step is to make it to deeper layers. And here I would like to stress also the work of Taco Cohen and Max Welling from Amsterdam. They put up a nice theory, and they applied deep convolutional neural networks to rotor translation group, where they constrained themselves to 90 degree rotations just to stay on the grid and to avoid interpolations. But we would like to, of course, work on the continuous setting, where you can decide yourself how many orientations that you included. And this is recently the paper by Eric Beckers, me and people in the biomark engineering department, and it was very well received at the MCI conference. So there we did also with deeper layers on SE2. So this is this work. But we're not the only ones, eh? So there's lots of people working on this topic. As you can see over here, also SE3 is currently being investigated, and SO3 and quotients. And here you see a quite complete overview of works that are currently working on group equivariant networks. Okay, so let us start now from the general machine learning perspective, the second motivation, rotor translation covariant convolution neural networks for medical image analysis. Okay, so here, for example, we see a problem. We see a histopathological slide here, and then we would find we want to identify mitotic figures. This is important for diagnosis of diseases, such as cancer. Then basically, you want to do this in a rotation translation covariant way. Basically, you have an input image, you have your convolutional neural network, you have your output, a label. And when I rotate and translate this patch, I mean, the label, the final assignment, the classification should not change, of course. And this is important. Now, here you see another example. Here you see a retinal image, you want to do a vessel segmentation. But if I put in my training data set all vertical lines, then, hey, if a vertical line comes in there, yeah, it works. But what happens if I rotate this line and I only trained basically for vertical lines, then it will no longer work. So what we need to do, and basically what the applied convolutional neural networks community often does, is to augment the data. So if you have the data, you have labeled data, you rotate your data, you augment this data, and then you can tackle with this problem. But it goes with the cost of a lot more complexity, where you waste your network capacity to train symmetries that you already could have included directly in the design of your network. You can see that over here. If you do this work with augmented, you augment all your training data by rotating it and then putting all the labels, you rotate it accordingly. But then you train, and then you see that the train filters, there's a lot of redundancy here because you see rotated versions of the same kernel all over the place. So if you include that in your neural network, then the symmetry, then you don't waste network capacity on training symmetries that you could know a priori that to be there. Okay. So problems with classical CNNs, no guarantee of equivariance, redundancy of feature representation, artificially create data sample by data augmentation. So the solution is to go for group convolutional neural networks. So they exploit the symmetries in the data, they have weight sharing, improved weight sharing, and improved geometry, and they perform better by not having to spend valuable network capacity on learning geometric properties. Okay, so here a little bit on with neural networks, so the problem description, given a training data set consisting of pairs of input and labels, find an operator indexed with weights, such parameterized by the weights that best maps each input to a desired output. And then, of course, you minimize a loss, and this minimization is then done by computed by stochastic gradient descent. where one relies on backward propagation via the chain law to make it efficient. And for these loss functions on the weights, basically you can, for example, do a least squares, but it's often also better to use a multi-class cross entropy loss function. Okay, so how does this look like in this application here? Here we see some input images, some labels, and then we do we optimize this loss, and then we get this network. The network, we apply it to a test image, and then we can say, hey, it's probably a healthy cell, or it's probably cell next to a mitotic figure. Okay, so with neural networks, basically the idea is you have a neural network is a composition of operators where each layer is of the following form. You have here a linear operator acting on X, you have a bias, and then you apply an activation function element-wise, and it's very popular to use ReLU functions for this. Okay, rectifying linear units. So then here we use this notation to remember we have the weights of the network, but we also have the biases, and omega is the combination of the two. So a classical neural network. So here we you apply this classical neural network, you apply these operators that I just showed, and then from each layer to each layer, and then this is the depth of the network, this is the width of the network, and then here you repeat this, and then at the very end you apply this phi to be a softmax or a Boltzmann distribution to go to class probabilities. Yeah. Okay. So this classical neural network, so you apply this linear mapping, and it's parametrized by the weights. But you have to be a bit careful here, because the dimension over which of the space over which you optimize can easily explode, of course, if you don't put some constraints on these operators AW. For example, if I have a fully connected neural layer, I have a full matrix here, you have way too many degrees of freedoms, and you do not actually exploit the structure of the data. So therefore, you do a convolution layer where you have localized transformation, shift equivariance, and sparsification of the linear operator, and weight sharing, which is very important. Okay, so, but then we go one step further. Oh yeah, so I should mention here about the input and output spaces. We can model this now in a continuous setting by L2, R2, and then we make multiple copies, and we stack these multiple copies to the output layer. So for each plane here to each plane here, you have basically a convolution that you train. Okay, so how does this work? Well, it's like with template matching. You take your kernel and you probe your data, and then you have one such convolution layer. Okay, so this is convolution layers on Rn, and then here you see typically how this looks like. You have your linear mapping, which is just a convolution with some collection of convolution filters. And then you can do standard deep convolutional neural network designs like Linette 5, where you have inputs and feature maps, and then you get some subsampling convolutions, and then at the end you get your output. Okay, but now let's take this from the group of translations covering position space to the group of roto-translations. So we know R2, that's a group, and then, but let's bring it to not just shifts, but also include the rotations. So, and then we have a semi-direct product, because the rotation part affects the translation part, that is always with rigid body motions. And then we can look at group representations of these rigid body motions, not only acting on the images, but also group representations acting on the scores. So I first have basically a lifting layer where I go to the score, and then here you have the group action over here. So if I rotate this image over here, it corresponds to basically a shift twist over here. So rigid body motion here corresponds to a shift twist. where if you go up in theta, you also move. Yeah, and then you see typically that the group structure is carried over to these operators on these objects. Yeah? Because that's typically for group representations. If you talk about the element G or UG or LG, this is the same because it's a homomorphism from the group to linear operators. Okay, so let's remember here the notation UG for rotating and translating images and the notation LG for rotating and translating the lifted images, the orientation scores. So first we have this lifting layer. This is something that we can train because it's just a convolution with a family of rotated kernels. That's basically this. You rotate and translate your kernel and then you probe your image F. So you can train this. These are the first weight factors. And then you get more weight factors here by subsequent group convolution layers on position and orientation space. So here you see, like, we lift the data to the position orientation space, and here you see if you apply a shift twist group convolution on the position and orientation space. Yeah, a remark I would like to make here, the equivariance that we want to keep track of. If I rotate and translate the images, I need also to apply shift twist transformations over these representations and deeper layers. It's important to mention here that a group convolution is also a correlation, because the only difference between a correlation and a convolution is that you put a check above the kernel, you invert your kernel. Inverting the kernel means that instead of you feed it a G, you feed a G inverse. Yeah? Think about normal translations and normal correlations and convolutions on Rn. Yeah? If you replace x by minus x, your correlation becomes a convolution and vice versa. Okay. So now let us have a look at this operator. So let's do a very general theorem here. So let X, Y be homogeneous spaces. Let a Lie group act transitively on the Y, and let mu and mu I be radial measures on X, respectively Y. And let us assume that there exists a function M such that for all G and G and for all X and X, this radial Nicodin derivative under the Lie group action is basically an L1 function M, independent of X. Let K be a bounded linear operator. And this is just a little extra assumption here, because it's not L2 here. If it would be bounded linear, normally you would expect L2 here, but I put L infinity there. Why is that? Because then I can apply the famous theorem by Dunford and Pettis, that every linear operator that is bounded, mapping bounded from L1 to L infinity, is in fact a kernel operator. So here, if I make this assumption, then I know by Dunford Pettis, hey, it is a kernel operator. Now, let A be left regular representations of the Lie group acting on these spaces such that it intertwines the operator K here, the kernel operator. Yeah, so AG acting on the space of images, BG acting on the space of scores, for example. But we'll see several examples of this later on. And since G acts transitively on Y, there exists an element in Y such that I can write Y as the group. There exists a group element such that I can put a reference element up to and map it up to Y. And then you can prove that because of the symmetry constraint over here, and these are left regular actions on the X and Y, that this kernel is a kind of a convolution kernel operator, as you can see over here. This is in the very general setting here. And there's one thing to keep in mind here. It depends, of course, on the choice of group, but if your group has stabilizers for the action onto Y, then we need an additional constraint for the kernel. So let us look at special cases. If X and Y are both L2 RD, then if I have a linear operator from L2 RD to L2 RD commuting with rotations and translations, it has to be an isotropic convolution. The theorem tells you, okay, then you get an isotropic convolution, which is also the reason why we have to extend the image domain from R2 to position an orientation space, because you can't stay in your space of R2 if you want to have rotation covariance with linear operators, because you get an isotropic convolution, and that's not, you don't take advantage of the elongated structures in your images. Okay, then there are other examples. For example, if the initial space is the space of images, and say the output space is the space of scores, or the full L2 over the group, then, and you can choose different groups. If you choose the similitude group, you get the continuous wavelet transform. If you choose the SE2 group, SE, the rotor translation group, you get basically the score transform, a coherent state transform. And basically, if X is Y is both over L2 over the group, then you get a group convolution. So the theorem imposes you have to use these group convolutions. If your space is not the full group, but the homogeneous space of positions and orientations embedded in your Lie group, and you have a quotient structure here, then you have additional symmetry requirements on your kernel. Like, for example, over here, you see that I have this additional symmetry requirement for the action of the stabilizer of A. Yeah? So this is one theorem, covers all these cases. And you know a priori, these are the only sensible linear operators to use. Okay, so that theorem will help us to do the group convolutional network design. Because here, the first part here, we have to go, that tells us we have to extend it to position orientation space. So we have this lifting layer, a lifting convolution. Then we have group convolutions. And each time this has to be a group convolution, because otherwise it will not be a rotor translation equivariant. There's one remark I would like to make, because in these neural networks you have to interleave these convolution layers with nonlinear activation functions, but they act in the codomain and they do not affect the equivariance. Okay, so this is the design. You have basically, you train the transform from images to scores, and then you basically, you train each convolution layer on the score. Okay, this detail I think I will skip. I will say something very briefly here. Just like with convolution layers, convolutions can be implemented via the Fourier domain. You can do that also on Lie groups and also on homogeneous spaces. So we have basically, you can do efficient Fourier implementations, but then you have to know a bit on the Fourier analysis on Lie groups. But then there are theorems like this also on the Lie group. And also thanks to some recent Fourier transform techniques that we applied on homogeneous spaces, we have also explicit formulas for doing shift-twist transformations on the homogeneous space of positions and orientations. This is not in the experiments. We did not rely on this, but I just want to mention it because there is a big field of doing steerable group convolution networks, and that basically boils down to applying a Fourier transform on the Lie group and on homogeneous spaces. Okay, so let us have a look at the specific example of the mitosis detection in the pathological slides here. So here you see in red the equivariance. So here is like this is the input image, the first layer. You lift it to the orientation score, the lifting layer. And then you see you get a high response at this orientation over here. And this gives you a high response over there. And then you do multiple convolution layers where each time you, because you shrink the boundaries, then you, at the end you end up with this output factor over here. Now here I rotate this image. And then you see, hey, the same image is over here, but you have to shift over theta and at the same time rotate spatially. And then it ends up over here. So you see, up to here, you have rotation equivariance. But at the final layer, basically, when you want to do for the application, you do an integration over all the angles, and that makes it invariant. And then you can see that indeed these feature vectors are the same. The two blue vectors are at the end the same. This one is the same as this, and because I take the maximum over theta, I get truly invariant representations by means of my equivariant group convolutional neural networks. Okay, here are some results that were achieved by Eric Beckers. I think they are really nice results. So Eric Beckers he implemented these group convolutional neural networks by adapting the basically in TensorFlow the code so that you adapt weight sharing for group convolutions. And then we applied it here. This is applied to here to histopathology, where you want to identify the mitotic figures. That's the one application that I already mentioned. Then you have here. This is optical images of the eye. You want to do the vessel segmentation. And here you have electron microscopy images where you want to do a cell boundary segmentation. Now, in each of these applications, we first considered, let's do normal convolutional neural networks where we augment our data. Augmenting the data is cumbersome, but you can do it, and you can then run the convolutional neural network. But then you waste a lot of network capacity on including the symmetries. And then you can see you do get good results with convolutional neural networks. But if you would not have augmented your data, so you just work with the original data, then you see you get a drop in performance. But then we are going to work, so n is here the number of orientations used in the group convolutional neural network. So we increase the number of orientations. And typically at n is 4, we are already on par with the result from the augmented usual convolutional neural networks working with augmented training data. But if we further increase the number of orientations, we get better performances, as you can see over here, in all three applications. It is, of course, very important that in your comparison, because if you put more orientations, that you don't increase your network capacity, because this would be an unfair comparison. So we did the network design in such a way that the network capacity is independent of the N. It would be unfair. If I increase my network capacity, I can get better results. So the network capacity is constant, but we do not waste network capacity on training symmetries that we know that they will be there. And that's the reason why you get better results with group convolutional neural networks, these equivariant group convolutional neural networks. And so now I would like to come to the conclusion of my talk. So we considered roto translation as a two covariant convolutional neural networks. The architecture consists of a lifting layer that constructs the orientation score. Then we have the group convolutional layers to process your orientation scores. And at the very end, interleaved with ReLU codomain transformations. And at the very end, we do a projection layer where we integrate over all the orientations to make the representation invariant. We had increased performance compared to 2D benchmarks that rely on rotation data augmentation of your training data. There is code available. Eric Beckers wrote really good code, well-documented code, and code and demos are available on GitHub. And here you can see where you can find this code. What I also would like to stress is this is actually the first step of relating differential geometry on Lie groups to the deep learning and machine learning techniques on these groups. Because this was only done for iterative group convolutions. But you can think that there are also other ways of doing a max pooling, for example. And you can also not just train convolution kernels, but you can also train morphological kernels for geodesic wavefront propagation. And this will be the next step to deal with more difficult, because now we basically trained linear group convolutional layers. But the next step will be to get a nice PDE description for group convolutional neural networks, equivariant networks. Okay. Just want to say that we had 3 applications where we got better results by deeper layers and multiple orientations. This concludes my talk.
We have time for 1 or 2 quick questions, if any.
Okay, so I'm wondering, so here you do the lifting at once, so is it possible to like delay the lifting or do progressive lifting if you have like embedded group, like, so the initial is just translation, but then you add rotation, but then you could add other invariants, and instead of doing a big lifting at once, you could do it during the networks, or even do lifting, then do pooling to remove invariants and then redo some lifting, like distribute the lifting in the architecture.
Yes, I think that is indeed possible, but I have to say that if you do, of course, if you do convolution networks and you delay the lifting, because if you do a linear operator that commutes with rotations and translations must be an isotropic convolution. So that if you delay this lifting procedure, that means that you first do isotropic convolutions, combine that with reluse or with nonlinear codomain transformations, and I'm not so sure if that is desirable. So I think this first step of doing the lifting is actually a consequence of this theorem, this general theorem that I recently set up. Because I wanted so together with Eric, I wanted to motivate basically, okay, why is this construction, is it really necessary? But I would say, because of this special case over here, it's more or less imposed that you have to do the lifting convolution, or you have to work with data augmentation for the first part, but I wouldn't know how that would work out. So I think this is more or less imposed, and also this group convolution here, this is imposed, because the only operator commuting with rotations and translations on the scores, this is a group convolution. But of course, here are better choices.
You can have an idea of what would be like a nonlinear operator.
An interesting class of nonlinear operators that would be invariant. Of course, this is like a very interesting, but it's very hard to analyze.
Yeah. If I, for example, when I studied so in the beginning of the talk. Yeah, with the PDEs here. Let's see, here it was, here. So here, basically with these crossing preserving diffusions, these are nonlinear PDEs and they are locally adaptive frames. And in that case, if you look at each step when you iterate your PDE, at each step you adapt basically your weights. And so we more or less can train kernels, convolution kernels, like we the convolution kernels are for linear PDEs. But of course, the big applications come when you could extend this to more non-linear PDEs. But of course, if I have linear PDEs and I concatenate them with codomain transformations, non-linearities kick in. And yeah, of course, you have to think well on what codomain transformations you use. But most importantly, also, and that's I think where a lot of gain can be made, is with the max pooling. Because there are other types of convolutions that could be done, and then you can do small steps, diffusion, Jacobi, and then iterate a bit, and then you will get very nice. It's basically work in progress to get a PDE description of methods people are already applying on convolutional neural networks. But that's in progress.
Okay, so let's thank Remco again.